This is Chapter 10 of A House Tale, which is a documentary of building a small house in the Virginia Blue Ridge Mountains. In this chapter, we'll discuss the electrical wiring for the house. I'm Sunny and you can see me here chasing deer, one of my favorite pastimes. Oh, well, I need to get on with narrating this chapter. It's all about juice, electrical juice. With the plumbing, see Chapter 9, getting wrapped up, we could finish the electrical wiring. The plumbing, drainage piping, and other related items have to go in particular locations with little flexibility. Thus, it drives the bus, so to speak. With the plumbing in place, we knew we were free and clear to run electrical wiring wherever we wanted without any conflicts. As mentioned in the previous Chapter 2, planning, we had already determined the electrical bill of materials well in advance, purchased the items, and had them stored in our basement. In most homes, the electrical outlets and overhead lighting are either on 15 amp or 20 amp circuits. A 15 amp circuit requires a minimum of 14 gauge wiring, while a 20 amp circuit requires a minimum of 12 gauge wiring. With this small house, we make the installation simple and just use 12 gauge wire on all outlets and lighting circuits. In order to make future troubleshooting easier, we typically set up a different outlet circuit, breaker, for each room, and for some of the rooms, multiple outlet circuits. We only had a total of 4 rooms, 5 counting the laundry room. As per building code, a separate 20 amp, 12 gauge, circuit was installed for the microwave, washer, and well pump. The kitchen countertop requires 2 20 amp circuits. 12 gauge wiring was also sufficient for the 240 volt bathroom heater and the mini-split heat pump. Other 240 volt items included the dryer where 10 gauge wiring was required and the oven where 6 gauge was required. The tankless water heater, also 240 volts, required 2 40 amp circuits, making a total of 80 amps, wow! We used 8 gauge wiring for each 40 amp circuit. If one is thinking about retrofitting an old conventional water heater to a tankless one, an upgrade to the electrical circuit will probably be required. This is the area for any TV and stereo equipment, extra outlets and TV cable were installed. There is no internet broadband in our area, so no Cat6 wiring was installed. If broadband becomes available, it was assumed a Wi-Fi system will be used. This is just a typical end of an outlet circuit. Another benefit of using 2x6 walls is that no nail plates are required. There is sufficient wood thickness between the wire and the covering that is being nailed to meet the code requirement. Here is some wiring near the front door showing the boxes for light switches and porch light. Here are some of the outlets for the kitchen countertop. All kitchen, bathroom, and laundry room circuits, outlets, are required to be on GFCI circuits. GFCI receptacles detect ground faults and immediately terminates power to prevent shocks. A ground fault is when there is a break of grounding, resulting in the possibility of the ground going through the user, not good. The 6 gauge wiring for the oven is also shown near the bottom. More kitchen area. The aux box is the plumbing for the refrigerator ice maker. Have you noticed the blackish compound where the wiring penetrates the top plate and bottom plate of the wall construction? This is fire-strip sealant as required by code to prevent possible fire from spreading, or at least delaying, into other parts of the house. Here's the start of the exhaust fan over the range. We tied the over-the-range microwave exhaust fan into this vent. Okay, let's take a break from all this construction mumbo-jumbo lingo. It really got hot in the house while we were installing the wiring. No insulation had been added yet. Rolling around on this soft grass in the shade gave me a chance to cool off. That was a nice break, but we need to get back to work. And here's the insulated copper lines that will be connected to the mini-split heat pump. This shows the backside of the bathroom electric heater. Well, let's talk about the electrical breaker box. Although with a house this small we could have gotten by with a service less than 200 amps, we went ahead and installed a 200 amp service and main panel box. This will allow future expansion without a major electrical service upgrade. We installed the breaker box back-to-back with the exterior meter base. This allowed the large 200 amp cables between the meter and main panel to be as short as possible, minimizing cost. One good thing about doing electrical in our tiny house was that we had no power while doing all the install. Dad could not fry himself. We found it to be the easiest part of building a house. Once one understands the fundamentals, it can be very monotonous, connecting wires to terminals over and over. The worst part, we ran a lot of cable in the attic, and it was in the middle of the summer, very hot, hot, hot. We installed a combo meter base. A combo meter base is a combination box that holds the power company electrical meter, in our case, AEP, but also has an area with breakers that can be accessed by the owner, without the need to contact AEP. You are thinking, why would I want this? Well, if you ever want to run electrical power to a future detached storage building, garage, shop, etc., you are already set up for it, making it fairly easy. This type of meter base has an AEP area that will be locked with tag when AEP installs the meter, and the area below it has the customer accessible area. If you are building a new home, we highly recommend this type of box be specified. The increased cost is insignificant. AEP provided guidance documents on how to install the meter base in accordance to their standards. Here's the meter base installed on the vinyl blocks that was shown in Chapter 8, Exterior Siding. The local building code officer verified that the installation was in order, and then contacted AEP to install the power from the newly set pole to the house meter. In our case, we went with an underground service versus an overhead service. With an overhead service, the owner would need to install a mast requiring a penetration through the roof. We wanted to avoid roof penetrations, more chances for future leaks. Underground services also look a lot better, and one does not have to worry about future ultraviolet degradation of the service lines. The only negative, AEP will charge for the installation from the pole to the house, approximately $500 in our case. They did have to extend the distribution line to the house, which was about 450 feet, which was cost-free. Here I am checking out the stake where a new power pole will be set. Dad told me not to mess with the stake, you would think he doesn't trust me, hee hee.